This is Essentials of Practical Alchemy of the 2016 workshop, and I'm Aubrey Forrest, the Modern Alchemist. And today, we're going to talk about Kabbalah and the Tree of Life. But before we do that, we're going to take a moment, we're going to review some material, and talk about what we've talked about so far, just to kind of get you up to speed. You will recall that we began by discussing that alchemy is a language and a science and an art, and that these are, it forms this interchangeable triangle or pyramid that can be spun around so that whatever your foundation is, that will reflect how you apply your knowledge, whether it's applied through language, communicating through art, or science working its way through language, any number of these things we discussed. And it's pivotal because you're going to see that as we move into the tree, it becomes very sophisticated because the lines between language, science, and art get really blurred. They get really, really blurred because this is a description, this diagram is a description that for a great number of interactions. This is an electric universe diagram that shows functionality of both projecting and receptive bodies. And which brings me to the second thing that we talked about when we discussed symbols and we broke them down. We talked about what complex symbols are and what simple symbols are. And so a simple symbol is like a color or a simple shape like a cross or a star. And a complex symbol involves combining many simple symbols together so that you have a larger, more complete idea or concept, which I call a cognitive thought form. So there's that. Then last week we discussed, what did we talk about last week? Archetypes, thank you. Mythology, mythological archetypes. And the thing that I wanted you to take away from that was an understanding of how planetary bodies are dualistic in their presentation of gender, depending on their context. So before we go too much farther, because that actually plays a big role in everything else that we're going to talk about, we're going to review that momentarily. So, as what I mentioned was that the flow of energy through any body, and that includes you as well, is top to bottom, and it flows like this, where at the top it's negative receptive, and at the bottom it's positive projective. So this is your north pole, and this is your south pole. So in one of the videos I recently did where I deconstructed some of the Overwatch cinematics, and I talked in the central story, there's this beautiful description of a story of two brothers, the dragon of the north wind and the dragon of the south wind. And the dragon of the south wind overcomes the dragon of the north wind and causes all this havoc. And that is a description of this electric universe dynamic. The two dragons, however, are two separate bodies in this case. But they're presented as a unified form because we both have both of these elements. From top to bottom, when you look at yourself and use your body as your guide, like the human body literally is your teacher. If you just pay attention to yourself, you're going to learn a lot about how the universe operates. Quite literally. If you pay attention to the process of thinking and feeling and understanding the generative forces that accompany those processes, you'll have a better understanding of yourself, and you'll be able to work whatever you're working on more effectively. Because the only way that this stuff works is if you understand who you are, what your context is in relation to everything else, and the forces that you want to call upon, whatever electromagnetic bodies or energies. That's where that comes from. So in last week's discussion, we talked about how in the presentation of gods and goddesses, a husband-wife, brother-sister combination that is unproductive, meaning that they don't produce children, is a description then of a singular body. So that the wife is the negative receptive top, and the husband is the positive projective bottom, which of course lends itself to a number of jokes, right? You know, so. This, by the way, also is a description of, if you go back in some of your more ancient Hebrew writings, which are descriptive of the goddess Lilith, and the description of her role and the fact that she was cast out because she wanted to be on top. What the description then of Lilith and Adam is a description of a singular body, a singular creation, where this is the feminine aspect and the masculine aspect, and together they are unproductive until another body is introduced. So when we get to that point, not in this workshop, but in later workshops or classes where we deconstruct biblical scripture and look for the esoteric component in there on an astrotheological planetary basis, you'll start to see all of these same rules apply for husband, wife, brother, sister. Yes, please.
What has not to have babies do with this thing?
Thank you. Electric universe is what that has to do with. And this is where we get into the tree of life. Dude, I couldn't have asked you to ask me a better question, Raul. That is awesome. So the tree of life, then, is a presentation of a flow of electromagnetic dynamism from top to bottom. So there are 10, but before we get to that, hold that question. Don't let me forget, please. Before we get to that, let's talk briefly about the word Kabbalah. In last year's class, I go to a greater length of explaining the difference. And thankfully, you know, as any good teacher, my understanding of these topics has increased over the year. So my opinion of them has also differentiated, and I'd like to share that with you. Because I get a lot of folks asking me, why is it that for myself, I choose to spell Kabbalah with a K when at another time it's spelled with an L, and then later in the 20th century it's spelled with a Q? And there's a reason. I've meditated on this for a long time. It took a while because you don't find a lot of explicit doctrine or dialogue in anywhere which describes why this transition. This transition has to do with moving through ages, okay? And when you realize it, it's so beautiful, it's so elegant, it's just gorgeous. When you start off with Kabbalah, the original Kabbalah was written from what I can determine, and we're going to draw a quick zodiac here. Our world, historically, we divide ourselves astrotheologically into 2,000 year ages, approximately. It could be a 2,165 year age, or it can be a 2,000 year age, depending on your perspective. And I feel free to check out "Is This the Dawn of the Age of Aquarius?" video, where I go at length explaining the dual perspectives between a 2,000 year age and then the more current apprehension of age, which is 2,160 years. Regardless of which age we're looking at, though, there are periods in which certain things were created. And when looking at the wheel of our life as human beings, this is right here, this is the vernal equinox over here, and this is the autumnal equinox, and this is the winter solstice, and this is the summer solstice, okay? So as we move from there, that tells us then that this here is Gemini. This is Cancer. This is Taurus. And this is Aries. And this is Pisces. And this is Aquarius, which is where I believe we are now. I used to have some doubt in my mind that we were in the age of Aquarius, but I am doubt-free now. I'm absolutely certain that we're in the age of Aquarius. Simply by virtue of the fact of all the massive transition in consciousness. Incidentally, I saw Star Trek. It was awesome. And is a starry gem on the crown of a herald for the Aquarian Age. I mean, the movie is so Saturnian in its themes. It's incredible. So let's get back to this. This Kabbalah, then, this is 2000, right here, before Common Era. Okay, this leads, if we take this calendar and move this way, this is called the precession of the equinox. As we work our way around this, as we work our way this way, counterclockwise, we have the precession of the equinox. When we're looking at sidereal astrology, which is the annual astrology, then it goes this way, right? Around. The precession of the equinox is a discussion of our positionality relative to the galaxy and its rotation, which takes about 24,000, 26,000 years, depending on who you read. I'm more inclined to go with the 26,000 year figure because this then is showing where the sun is in proximity to the center of the galaxy. Check out the Age of Aquarius thing. I don't want to get tied up with that. So let's look here really quick. So this then was written or produced at least during this period, which puts it in the Age of Aries, before Common Era. There are a number of reasons why, which would support this. One, the commencement of sacrificial ordnance work with relation to rams and goats, which, and Moses, of course, falls into this area. This is the bedrock from which the Hebrew religion is created in this period here, and in the 2,000 years prior to that. The world, according to that religion, starts at 3751. before Common Era. So these dates then place it here, and this becomes then the discussion of learning this material as it was originally taught. Okay? When you get to Kabbalah with the sea, this is a transition. This is an update of Kabbalah based on the age of Pisces and its understanding. So last year I said, Kabbalah with a C is like a Christian Kabbalah. Still true, but you got to understand who Christ is, right? And understand that this is a reference to the sun, okay? So the Kabbalah then is transitioning from a reference to the cube here to a reference to the sun later on. And when you get to here with the Q, the Kabbalah with the Q is the reference to the Age of Aquarius and the new thinking in association with Kabbalah. This is your magical, mystical Kabbalah. This is much more religious, and so if you want to learn astrotheology, then you want to look up here for what the original meanings were for various archetypes. Not going to forget about the whole male-female thing. That's going to come up. But the idea here then is that you're looking at Kabbalah 4,000 years ago, Kabbalah is interpreted 2,000 years ago, and Kabbalah is interpreted in the 20th century. And one of the finer books that you can get for yourself in having a really clear understanding of Kabbalah is Dion Fortune's Mystical Kabbalah. I've mentioned this in a few other classes. I use this book a lot simply because it's so well written. I like the author. She's clear, she doesn't mess around, and she gives you a nice, concise understanding of what you're looking at. Any image of the Kabbalah that you see that looks like this, this is Kabbalah with a Q, and it shows the Tree of Life, and each of the paths are defined by the tarot, and by different tarot cards. So we're going to talk about that when we get to that point. Please don't let me forget to talk about tarot, okay? Because that's really important. So does this sort of get you to this point where you're seeing that each of these are transition? This brings me then to, you know, I mentioned the Bible a lot in here. And the reason for it is because it is such a well-concealed secret. It's been so badly abused by those who would say they think they understand what it means. And as a result, it's driven people away from it. When in truth, that book basically represents the archive of the Age of Pisces and its interpretation of all preceding ages. So it's an update of all those old stories, which is why you see so much similarity between Old Testament stories, and then if you go over into Sumer, suddenly you find out all those same stories are actually being retold in one form or another there, and if not there, you might find them in Asia, or you might find them in South Africa. I mean, the ideas are being presented universally because we're not talking about an existential exercise. Even though all of the current writers over the last 2,000 years have brought existentialism into it, the truth is that it's to teach you about yourself, which I guess is an existential exercise. But the idea is its foundation is built around something that people saw and experienced. And then they use this as a tool to get to their, to a greater point of understanding. All right. We still live? Yay. All right. Stars are limit. It was so weird last week. Just couldn't stay alive. So this then, and when I describe it, like on my channel, I'm constantly using Kabbalah with a Q, because I'm teaching you astrotheology. I'm showing you, I'm pulling the mask off. It's Scooby-Doo time, folks, right? You know, we want to see if it's Old Man Winters or whoever the heck it is. You know what's really funny about Old Man Winters? Just sidebar. It's a Saturn reference, right? Because winter is the season of death. And anyways, they never stop. Like this stuff, it's embedded in so many places. Star Trek was so awesome. I want to do an esoteric smackdown for you, but you're going to have to wait till like, do my presentation, which is coming up on the 11th of August. All right, so let's look at Kabbalah then. So here it is. This is the Tree of Life, and it's designed by placing 10 little spheres, and there's actually 11th right here, which we mentioned. Each one of these are considered what are called a way, or a sephira, okay? And they represent a point in consciousness, but they're also descriptive of how the universe operates. So when you understand that each one of these has this dualistic property, where they're both male and female at the same time, but it depends on their context, right? Who's around them and who's doing what with them. That determines their gender, their effective gender attribute. So, let's begin. There are 10 of these, and they're tied to all but two are tied to planetary influences, which is why I've been focusing on learning the planetary characteristics. Like, what are these planets like? I choose to do it this way for a couple different reasons. One, it makes learning Kabbalah readily accessible because you need only turn on your TV and your brain or a movie and start looking at what people are doing to see where they might fit into this tree, because they'll have characteristics and stuff which will show them that they belong on here somewhere. The other reason is because I believe that this material is designed to teach. It's just not designed to teach everyone. It's designed to teach those who are either prepared to learn, have had some kind of background in this, or are attentive. Everyone else, it's very much like, for instance, in the Globe Theater, back in the time of Shakespeare, he would write a series of plays, which anyone who's been, you know, to college and had a course in literature understands that the narrative complexity of Shakespeare cannot be underscored sufficiently, okay? And that's why this work endures for centuries. The work itself, however, goes shoom over everyone down in the pit, okay? Whereas all the people who are actually paying for Shakespeare to write, who are up on the upper areas, it's them and their children that are benefiting, okay? These are the wealthy elite who have the education and the knowledge to know that they're looking at something more than just a simple play, or a movie, or a TV show. So, with that said, let's take a look at this. The first sephirot is Kether. Kether is known as the hidden of the hidden. It is pure potential, and it is the source from which everything flows, but Kether in and of itself is kind of in its own little stasis, but it drives, it is that part of the universe which can never be touched, because it's just outside of our influence. It's still part of the universe, but it is the thing which drives everything else. And so you can't quite get to there because everything is starting to manifest in multiple ways before you even approach Kether. So it is the unknown of the unknowns. Like that's the idea behind it. Here we have Chokma. And both of these are considered masculine aspected. Kether, as he's driving, however, when Kether's driving energy into Chokma, Chokma momentarily becomes negative receptive, right? It has to absorb that. So this is that part where if this was, let's say, an unproductive husband-wife pairing, you have a third body in there, and then something else can get produced. And in this case, we have energy flowing from Kether into Chokma, and this is all still pure force. This is just pure energy. This is pure power just flowing in a single directed line, right? There's just, it's that idea of masculine, straight-on projected energy, from which is infinite. As it moves, and this is number two, as it moves this way, it finally collides into something that makes it stop and defines it. At this point, it is infinite, eternal, undefinable, because it has no boundaries. It has no limitation. It's just energy. But the moment you pop limitation into it, and this is 76, right? This is, I'm sorry, that's a, I'm thinking Capricorn. So this is actually ruled by Saturn, and this is Bina. And again, we have negative and positive. So the energy drops down into Chokma, and then from Chokma, it moves into Bina. And this is irresistible force against an immovable object. Okay? Bina, and her, this is the Great Mother. The gift of Bina is not life. The gift of Bina is death. It is the first promise that is made when you are born, and is the only promise that is ever guaranteed to be kept, and that is that you will die. This is, in fact, philosophically, and Bina is characterized, this is Father and Son and Mother. This is your Trinity. And don't get tied up on the fact that the Son is having forced, you know, forcing energy into the receptive body of the Mother or anything like that. It's not an Oedipus complex, although I suppose you could definitely see the relationship, right? Anyway. Moving this way then, so Bina is Saturn. Now everything that you know about Saturn then applies to this sphere. Everything, every characteristic, every deity that is tied to that. And this is where in your mind you start throwing together this mental correspondence book, right? Where you're like, Saturn also is Kronos, is also, you know, and moving along, because each one of these gods then that represents Saturn also represents the characteristics of the sphere of Bina. All of it. And when you remember to contain that, then now learning mythology is really useful, because it makes learning all the rest of this, as you'll see, much faster, because you're putting a face on it. And this is why anciently, I believe, our ancestors, when they would look up and they would see the sphere of Jupiter up there, way closer than it is today, they would personify that with the countenance of a human being, so that we would, you know, we make our gods in our image, so that subjectively we can understand or at least interpret what's going on. So, Kether, Chokma, and Bina. The lines which are in between them, these are called paths, and there are 22 paths between each of these Sephiroth. Just like in the tarot, there are 22 major arcana cards. So each major arcana card will teach you the nature and complexity and attributes of these paths, and therefore it will teach you how to interpret what it is going on between these two folks. So in this case, where's my book? Are we pacing this okay for you guys? Doing good? Okay. So, in this case, moving from sphere 1 to sphere 3, the card that you would see placed there would be the Magician. Moving from sphere 1 to sphere 2, the card between them would be the Fool. So this gives you immediately an idea of the composition both of those two major arcana cards, the fact that they actually are standing next to each other when you look at them. If you look at the Rider-Waite deck, the two cards, the Fool and the Magician, when you place them together, you can see that they look like they're literally two sides of the same coin. The Magician requires everything in front of him to prepare and to lay it out so that he can do his thing, and the Fool is like, I'll just run with it and I've got my bag. And both are equally adept, but one tends to be more fluid and the other tends to be more static. One tends to be more rigorous in its application of understanding, the other is a bit wiser. And in fact, the Fool is the wise one among the two of them, because his path then falls down the pillar of wisdom. And this side here is the pillar of understanding. But we'll cover that too. There's so much composition here. So from this point here, we have the upper trinity. Now everything below this becomes a manifestation into the material world. So everything above this is rules that define the manifestation that comes up down here. And by understanding that principle, you can then begin to draw on these forces within yourself and within the world around you. Da'ath, we will talk about some other time. We're not going to confuse things by talking about there, but I wanted you to see that the seed of life is present here, right? As well as there's a six-pointed object. And if I put that little Da'ath back in here, I guess like the little Star of David. You can see that, right? Triangle. Triangle. Okay, so moving this direction then, the next sphere, number four, and four is a numerological indication of stability. So when you look in the tarot, the number four is often typified by four posts, or there's a guy holding on to four coins. Each indication of a four is a slowing down or stabilization of something that's taking place. This is Jupiter. Let's see. I'm momentarily having a... There we go. Jupiter. And remember, negative, positive. So momentarily, Jupiter is receptive negative, right? And it's receiving energy from Saturn. And it's becoming something. Now this actually is giving us a story, but in order to understand the story, we have to get down here first and understand why this is called the Sun, as well as just the Sun, all right? Moving from Jupiter, and Jupiter's role, astrotheologically, Jupiter is a preserver. Jupiter is seen, then, as the god Zeus. Jupiter is also seen as the god Horus. Jupiter is seen as the god Vishnu. Jupiter is also seen as the god Ganesh, because he's a remover of obstacles. Which these are all things that Jupiter has done physically for our solar system, right? It's a giant electromagnetic vacuum cleaner that as it moves in its 12-year orbit around the sun, it collects and cleans up everything for the inner planets to make sure that the asteroid field is nicely shepherded where it is, right, instead of shooting off into us all the time. Jupiter, under the pillar of mercy, represents its color, by the way, is blue. And on the opposite side, this color is red. And the one object that stands in opposition to Jupiter is Mars, which is like that, negative and positive. I'm so excited for the last class, because once we lay all this foundation, you'll be able to see that this is telling us a story as we move through all of this. But first off, let's understand Mars falls under Saturn, and so Mars is all about establishing order, but it's a suppressive order. It's we will unify, we will pull together. Jupiter is about freedom. Jupiter is about liberty. Jupiter is about having mobility in the outside world, which is requiring of that freedom. Mars is about structure. So when we look at our political parties, they actually fall exactly Kabbalistically where you would expect them. The Democrats fall over here under the blue, and I kid you not, left-wing politics is over here. Remember, you want to become the tree. So you step back into it, and now you're the tree of life, right? You have to start subjectively doing this with everything that you study, if it's involved in mythology or the esoteric. You can't use it unless you know what it feels like to be it, right? Because otherwise it's just your imagination. You're just pretending. You're not actually participating. So in this case, Republicans are over here. Right-wing politics. And everything that you would expect a Republican to talk about would be talked about by Mars here, right? Because the Republicans' number one tool of diplomacy is war. You know, that's why you got the war hawks and stuff like that over here in the military-industrial complex. All this stuff is over on this side. The strong family values are over here, because that falls under Saturn, who's the lawgiver. And as we've talked in other classes, any time that you have a religion that dictates how you're supposed to behave and eat and when you should or should not have sex or families or whatever, that's Saturn talking. That's not over here. There's a different object talking. And now we're going to talk about that object. So in the very center then, so this is number five, by the way. Number five is Mars. In the very center is number six, and this is the sun. This is the sun right here. And I'll just write the word sun a little clearer. Now the sun has a really fascinating role, and this is not something you're going to read about. I've never read it. This took me a while to just track it. This is something that is. I'm convinced it's something mouth to ear. It just has to be. Or something that you can gain simply by looking at it. There is a planetary absence here. This is considered a cosmic influence. And the only way to determine what would fit into this is by understanding our narrative. And that our narrative is that we were here, orbiting Saturn anciently, and that this orbit was disrupted as we were captured by another body. And this description is described as tortoise carrying a scorpion across a river, this description of two brothers meeting out in the wilderness. It's described in any number of different ways and settings, but ultimately what it means is that the sun is operating as an agent for the Pillar of Mercy and for Chokma. Because everything the sun does historically fulfills this. The sun is associated with forgiveness. And in order to understand the idea of forgiveness, you have to kind of dismantle the word a little bit. It means that you have already prepared to give something to someone beforehand, before it ever happens, which means built into the nature, the physical nature of the sun, was the capacity to absorb any disruption that would cause us to be wiped out if we were forgiven. In other words, we were given a place in orbit around the star that we didn't earn. It was just there. It just happened. And we're participants in this. We will discuss that at much greater length when we talk about our occulted human history in the last class. But for now, it's helpful to understand that the sun itself acts as both a destroyer and as a savior. This is very much other deities that could be tied to the sun then would be the Lord Shiva, right? And in fact, it's fascinating that he's known as Lord Shiva, because the idea of a lord is someone who is ruling for something else, right? I am the lord of this land, but there's a greater power that I'm standing in for, like a king, right? Or something. In this case, then, the term Lord in Hebrew is Adonai. So if you write Adonai Elohim, then you're saying the Lord God, which is standing in the place of Saturn, which was the original father. So this is the original father. This is the supplanter. This is Jacob. This is Lucifer, who is the bearer of light and darkness. the sun fulfills all of these roles. And if you, as we talked about last week, the five-pointed star is tied, although it is the attribution, it's one of these really neat opposites that happens all the time, between these two stars. There's the five-pointed and the six-pointed. This star is considered a masculine star, and this one's considered representative of the sacred feminine. But the irony is that it's because of the custody of the prepositional phrase. In other words, who's owning the star? So this is considered the star of David, but then you have to understand who David is, and that David is, in fact, a representative of the sun. It's another name for the sun. And there's an entire chain of associative names that bring you to that, not the least of which is David means beloved, and a title given to the sun is beloved. It is the beloved sun, literally. That's the title. So when you see this, this then is the beloved son, or the David son. So the son of Kether, the son of the father, then fulfills this. Does that kind of make sense? That's real complex stuff, you guys, but it's once you start seeing it play out, it becomes much more simple. In terms of movies, you see these three guys all the time working together. Or maybe these four. A lot of times you'll see Saturn thrown in there. And in most films, you'll see if it's like a buddy cop or any kind of thing where you have two characters standing next to each other, then it's the Sun and Saturn in opposition to each other, almost always. There'll be a blonde guy and a dark-haired guy or girl. Or they might just go with an ethnic thing and go with one guy's African-American and the other guy is white, like in Lethal Weapon, right? Where Murtaugh has got the gruff voice, right? I'm too old for this stuff. Well, that gruff voice is actually a biblical reference to Moses and the fact that Moses didn't speak very well. So he used Aaron to speak for him, which is Jupiter. So Moses uses Aaron to speak for him. Get it? The larger body, electromagnetically. We'll cover that in another time. So moving back through this then, continuing on down, we have number 7, and this is Venus. And as you can see, we begin to start seeing almost a genealogy take place of associations, because if the sun is tied up here, then the sun plus Jupiter produces Venus, and there's an entire body of mythology that would support that idea, not the least of which you can find in the Old Testament. Venus is tied to partnerships. Venus is also associated with a hunter god or goddess. Not, I'm talking about the planet, not the mythological goddess of love, who's Aphrodite, because Venus, the association with the hunter is associated with our subjective perspective of what it looks like when we look at Venus. We either see it in the early hours of the morning, right, where it's now it's, you know, pursuing the sunrise, or we'll see it as it pursues sunset. But it's because Venus is closer to the sun than we are, so it looks like it's either going to be on the front end or the back end. The idea of the morning star type...
Well, we've got a question online.
Oh, sweet! We got an online question. Let's do it.
Tom would like to know, did the sun save us from something by entering our solar system or our Saturnian system?
Yes. Yeah. In fact, what the sun did was it both saved and damned us. It broke a system which was set in place, which essentially was perfect. The idea is this. Think about babies. A baby produced inside the womb of a mom is 100% adapted for everything that's there, and there's nothing that hurts it, including eating its own feces and its hair off its body. And I mean, babies are hardcore in the womb. They're seriously hardcore. And yet, you know, the stuff that we know they do inside there, which causes them no harm at all, outside here would be detrimental, right? So in the same context, we were in a situation where the environment was 100% conducive for our growth and our productivity. From my own study and my own observation of what it must have been like, if there was a thing like death or aging, it was probably due to some kind of, you know, catastrophic injury or whatnot. But it seems to me that a system that is built around there would be no cancer, right? You wouldn't have diseases like you see today. You wouldn't have opportunistic pathogens which are trying to eat you. Everything right now wants to kill you or eat you, like on a big level or a small level. And to me, it seems like that's a system that was broken and then restarted. And when you recognize that scripturally that concept is supported in the idea that the Son is no respecter of persons, right? It says the Lord God is no respecter of persons, which is Adonai Elohim, which is the Son. And that means that the light that is shed and electromagnetically infuses everything on this planet, it's good for viruses as much as for human beings. So that's that. Did I get that question, you think? Yeah, so that's that. Did it save us? It did, but it also damned us. So we are, in many ways, the sons of perdition. We're the sons of destruction. We're what's left over, as well as the sons of Saturn, because that's the physical origin point. In terms of ourselves, when you look at the tree, we represent both sides. We're hybrids. We represent the physical construction that is provided by being encapsulated into a body within Saturnian, you know. And Saturn then fulfills a role, by the way, that is universal, right? It's not unique just to this planet. It's not like special. The idea is that when something is introduced to a stable static system, that then changes and becomes something else. So we changed. We became something else. The biggest thing, I think, that changed for us was that reproductive capacity became voluntary. And our ancestors got really excited about it, which is why you see so much phallus worship 4,000 years ago, like just crazy amounts of sex. And it's because I think that was probably something where we were just free to do it whenever, instead of being bound, like, you know, animals are bound, you know, in seasons. Like Vulcans are bound, right? Every 7 years, and then suddenly they lose their crap and they have to go do their thing in Ponfar. We're freed from that. We can do whatever we want, whenever we want, and that freedom is part of the gift, right? That's that thing. You're not in prison anymore, you're out. If you look at the Garden of Eden, it's more a jailbreak than it was anything else, right? Because it was static, nothing changed, and then suddenly you got, you know, people have babies. So Venus, goddess of love, this is the second planet, and moving in here to number 8, this is Mercury. Little crown there. We'll talk at greater length about Mercury, but this planet itself is a unique case for a number of reasons, not the least of which is the name it inherited, which is Hermes. We talked briefly about that last week. We'll cover it in better detail. Moving finally down here to number 9, this is the Moon. And then down here at number 10 is the Earth. So, when we're working, and I'll draw these arrows for you so you can see the flow of energy. Wow, does that look like hieroglyphics or what? Is that crazy? It's okay? I was just like looking at it going, oh my gosh. So hopefully online audience, you guys are okay with this. It'll get better in the other version. How are you doing? Everyone in here, you guys following me? Okay. So these are the 10 Sephiroth. There are 22 paths that go in between everything. I'm going to erase this in about 2 seconds. So if you guys are copying, need more time? No? Yes? No? Okay. Because I'm going to clean it up here. We're going to do it again, but we're going to show you a separate way to look at this. So those are the 10 Sephiroth and the 22 paths. We're going to pop it up one more time. And now I'm going to show you the pillars. Yes. Okay. All right, so Now you know the names of each of these, right? 1, 2, 3, 4, and the planetary associations. Remember the planets. Remember these associations as you begin to start. We'll talk about those in just a sec. Let's work on the columns here. There are three pillars in the tree. On the right, and there are different names for the same pillar, so it gives you an increased understanding of the complexity of the pillar itself. Headed by Saturn, this is the pillar of understanding. This is also known as the pillar of severity. It makes sense that understanding and severity would come at the same point, because to truly understand means that you understand that there is a clear definition between one thing and another, which can make you severe, right? The opposite to this, and I will always be defining these as in opposition to the other, because you can't really understand it on its own. It has to rest comparatively against its dualistic opposite so that you can see its whole face. On the other side, this is the pillar of mercy. This is also the pillar of wisdom, right here. And at the head of this one is the sun, which is standing in as an agent. This is, the sun standing in as an agent. So all of the attributes associated with the sun then can be applied to this side over here, which includes the sun's capacity to induce a chaotic environment. So cartoon or movie characters that could be considered solar are those that really destabilize stuff. Lethal Weapon is a great example of this, right? This is Riggs over here, who's crazy and wild. In the first movie, right, he's trying to help a suicide guy who's going to jump. And how does he help him? By jumping off the building with him, right? Because that's what the sun would do, you know? It's just this crazy. On the other side, this is Murtaugh over here, right? Conservative, family man, has this whole orbit of stuff around him that's completely destabilized the moment he's introduced to Riggs, right? His house gets exploded. I mean, literally, like, he goes through 30 years of police work and never has a bump, and then he runs into Riggs, and of course, 30 years, right? That's a reference to the orbital pattern of Saturn, right? So he's ready to retire, and no, he's doing his whole thing. So the sun will do that to you. It'll break things up, it'll shake it up. This is the pillar of mildness in the middle, and it's almost never really discussed in fiction or film because it doesn't give you the comparative dichotomy. The thing that is discussed is you'll see a person stand right there in the middle, working with both hands, applying their understanding. The solar character in the middle here could be Captain Kirk. And then on this side is Bones, and on this side is Spock, right? Spock gives you the logical, concrete, rationalized idea, and Bones gives you the passion. And what's beautiful is that Bones and Spock are literally the same person. They're two sides of the same coin, which, when they're apart from each other, their personality traits aren't so intense. When they get close to each other, suddenly Bones is just super emotional and accusing Spock of being insensate, and Spock is constantly looking at him and saying, you're just too emotional. But when they're apart from each other, you don't see Bones being on this emotional overtures all the time. You don't see Spock doing that, necessarily, being, oh, you're too emotional, especially in the face of Kirk. So this is Saturn and the Sun working their way down. Pillar of severity, pillar of understanding, pillar of mildness, or I'm sorry, pillar of mercy, pillar of wisdom. On this side, the reason why understanding is under Saturn is because it goes back to this process of energy flowing into the universe and then stopping here. Saturn, the idea of Saturn is where the buck stops. So, it is the thing which it's the force in the universe which restricts, binds, contains, and defines. So those are all the things on the opposite side of this, then under Chopra, as agent from the sun working up there, it's literally the opposite. The sun doesn't bind, It doesn't restrict. It allows things to break out and to manifest into new and interesting forms. So there's that. How are we doing? Oh, we're doing wonderful. You guys good? Online community, you guys okay? Right? Any more questions?
Tom would also like to know if these three pillars, if they correspond to the movement of energy in the yogic tradition.
Yes, actually they do. And you can work at aligning yourself by your chakras, by working through these two ideas. There is a kundalini that takes place. And that's part of this whole thing where it goes like this, and it comes down. But it also, remember I said last week, the energy that moves through your body is coaxial, just like everything else. So while the vast majority of it is doing this routine, right, because your dietary system, everything is working out, your heart is being charged from the solar plexus and pumping up this way. So you also have energy shooting up in the opposite direction. The key then is learning how to draw this energy up while at the same time pulling this energy down. And this is learned by studying this, because you go then from Malkut, which is the earth, and you move yourself up, and then you work your way back, literally just the opposite. And you can see now you've got the two serpents, you've got your caduceus, right, working its way up. And the sun and the moon become two of your central focus points for that process. It begins in the moon, and it binds itself in the sun. And the idea here, and this is for everything, the moon has a huge generative aspect for us astrotheologically, but also just consciously. Like you talked about how it influences us. We just came out of a full moon. It was awesome, beautiful. And, you know, we get to experience that heightened electromagnetic state. The moon represents the unconscious mind. Okay, this is that part of yourself which is every bit as real, every bit as valid as the conscious state that you're in. Descartes says, there's a paraphrase, but and he's a French philosopher if you'd like to know. He says, any tool or system or logic conventional wisdom that we would use to define our waking experience can also be used to define our sleeping experience, because people go to work in their dreams, they have sex in their dreams, they deal with children, and they also fly and breathe water and all this other stuff. So the question then is, which one's more real? And the answer is, yes. They're both more real. They're both as real as you want it to be, because we can get caught in that rabbit hole right away. What's real, right? If it's this, what's Morpheus say? If it's what you see and touch and feel, then now we're back to electricity, which brings us right back to the core concept in alchemy, which is that everything is mental, that the entire universe is thought. Everything that we do, everything, it's all thought. We're living the dream. Okay, so yes, now the sun then represents our conscious state, and it of course is, when you consider its electromagnetic influence, solar radiation, the sun's light, creates our circadian rhythm, you know, so that we actually are tied to the rising and setting of sun. And anyone who's worked graveyards, like Tony and I, we both know when you fight that rhythm, man, you pay a heavy price after a while. So, because not just your mind and consciousness is geared towards working with the sun, but literally, having my own experience working 5 years graveyards, back in the day going through school, you sense a sense of separation from that consciousness. It's really weird. It's disjointing. And it's one of those experiences where unless you've actually done it for a long time, you really won't be able to gauge just how weird it gets, you know, because you're going to work and everyone's sleeping. All right. So this is the tree of life in its most, it's all screwed up. This is the tree of life in its most fundamental form. From this, we can learn planetary. Now I'm going to get back to answering that question. Unproductive couplings, right? So, let's say this is more energetic. So, for the sake of argument, we'll do this. We'll make the sun, and then we'll make a smaller body down here, etc. It's pretty close to the scale. Electromagnetically, when these two bodies come together, you know, this is kind of cool. Someone wrote me a while back, if we have time, if you guys are into it, I don't know if we have time, but someone wrote me what I think about what's going on at CERN. And it's all electromagnetic. The principles are virtually the same. And the idea is, when this larger body is dumping energy into this receptive body, this receptive body can do two things. It can inflate, or it can seek to, because it's going to try to reach a charged state equilibrium, okay? So this body can either inflate like a balloon and get bigger, or it can cav off and create another body around it so that there's an additional body that can absorb the charged state. This then is a description of the Sun interacting with Saturn and producing Jupiter. Okay? And when you study the art of the period wherein this took place, you have this is a theme. If something is doing like this, this can be an elephant trunk. This can also be a lock of hair off of the side of, I'm going to do this right here so you can see. So you cannot see the electromagnetic influence pumping into this. However, anciently, as it's producing this, you've probably seen these pictures of plasma being funneled off of a star, and they're saying that this is actually a black hole or some bullshit. What this actually is a star, a baby star that's feeding off of its birthing parent, and it's drawing plasma. And this idea of this thing coming off the side then is later shown in Egyptian art, where a little boy, let's say, he'll have a little scalp lock come like this, right? Off the side of his head. And of course, he's got one eye here, and that gives you the eye of Jupiter with the scalp lock. Right? It also gives you a Ganesh with his little trunk sucking water off of the planet Saturn, which is tied to the element of water. You know, there's a number of things. This idea, then, is that the smaller electromagnetic body is influenced, just like in Kabbalah, and then will generate a secondary body. It can either get bigger or it can create one of these. Now, briefly, this is just for fun, just to kind of wrap it up and give you something fun to think about between this week and next week. CERN works like this, right? And then you got the second little thing down here. And the power, they take and they supercharge particles, right. Shoot them around electromagnetically to cause a collision. At the same time, there's a smaller ring on the other that's running in the opposite direction. And the idea is when it gets to this point, you get your collision here and they get to see stuff, right? This idea, and this is going like this, this idea can be seen in the womb with babies. So that when a baby is inside the womb, this is the womb, and here's your baby, let's say that's your baby's head up at the top, electromagnetically, for the first 8 months, the baby aligns itself top to bottom with mom, right? So everything is lined up, so mom's head's up here, baby's head's down here, and all of the equipment is all working in the same direction until suddenly a chemical is discharged from mom that says it's time to reverse, and the child polarizes in opposition to its mother. So that the head now is pointing downward, Now the head's getting ready to go out, right? In the same sense, if you have a large machine and you're doing this, now this is for fun, you guys, this is just because it's fun and answering that question. This machine, this point right here, it is theoretically possible that anything that is inside here can be gated out someplace else. Stargate. This is that point. So electromagnetically, you're taking a group of whatever and you're literally birthing them to someplace else. Like you're pushing them out. And that's the theory anyway. So I don't think I tried that. I wanted to get that one. I've been asked that a couple times just for fun, and I'm like, I was avoiding it. But since we're here, you can see the whole Kabbalistic idea of the energy then, in when it's in polarization to its source, will then push it down to the next stage below it. So, all right, I think that's it. We're actually right on time. We got through the whole thing. So that's Kabbalah. That's really a scaled down basic, and we've talked about Kabbalah a lot on this channel. A lot. And we'll keep talking about it, because the idea is as you begin to understand that each of those little spheres can be interpreted as people, like people you know, people like your friends. You know, Mercury, real talkative, charming, gets things done real quick-minded, great with business. Venus, someone who deals with people really well. The Moon, perhaps someone who's emotionally in tune with themselves or with others, or perhaps maybe they're moody. Maybe they have an affinity with water. Maybe they work in a kitchen because the Moon likes to cook. You know, things like that. Mars, this is the guy who's a go-getter, an athlete, someone who gets it done. Jupiter, perhaps an advocate, someone who sticks up for the little guy. These, as you begin to start seeing that, and then the Sun is the show-off, right? He could be a liar, and he could also be the super awesome, amazing guy who has incredible luck, or girl, or whatever. But when you start putting faces on all these little spots of, you know, these little dots, when you start seeing them as people instead of just existential exercises, you'll be able to use it. Like, you'll be able to actually use it, because this is the architecture to create an effective working. And that's what the practical side of alchemy is all about, is to make that work, to make a change so that you can change yourself, change your environment, like rock and roll with it. All right, that's all I got. Thank you, guys. I'll see you next week. And we'll be talking about more exciting stuff in Essentials of Practical Alchemy. That's it.